morning. See everybody this morning. We're so thankful for your presence. As has already been stated, I know we have a lot of folks visiting with us, and we're grateful that you are here and hope that you will come and be with us once again and any opportunity that you might have as we strive to worship our God in spirit and in truth here at the Hopkinsville Church of Christ and to strive to be pleasing to God as we go to His Word and try to help others come to knowledge of the truth and to desire to obey Him. So again, we're thankful that you are here, and hopefully we will get the chance to meet you if we have not already. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein and put incense thereon and offered strange fire before the Lord. And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. Leviticus chapter 10, verses 1 and 2. The issue of authority has long been a challenge and a problem as far as religion is concerned. In fact, it was a very big issue, a major issue, when our precious Lord was here on this earth, came and dwelt among us, as John chapter 1, verse 14 tells us. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 23, the chief priests and the elders came to Jesus and asked him, "Well, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" See, they didn't understand that Jesus' authority came from the Father. And that matter of authority was settled once and for all, as Jesus proclaimed in Matthew 28, verse 18, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." And so all authority resides with Jesus. When it comes to doing things according to God's way, some people, unfortunately, never stop and ask the question, "Well, do I have authority to do this thing? Whatever this thing might be, does God authorize me to do this?" And because that question is sadly not asked in the minds of many folks, that is the reason why there is such a thing called denomination and denominationalism. You ever stop and think about the idea that if everybody just said, "Let's just stop a moment and let's go back to the Bible and let's see what God says about things," there would be no such thing as denominations nor denominationalism. This morning we want to observe an example where two individuals by the name of Nadab and Abihu did something for which they had no authority under the Old Testament system of worship. And we want to see what God's response was to their going on and doing something the way they wanted to do things. What did God do in response to that? Since we have been given, as the Bible says, a better covenant, built upon better promises, Hebrews 8, verse 16, folks in the religious world today need to stop and ask themselves, "Well, is God any less concerned about authority today than He was long ago?" We have been studying a series of lessons on Sunday mornings for the past several weeks entitled "Lessons from the Law of Moses," in which we have observed it's not what we are under today. We know that law has been nailed to the cross, Ephesians 2:15. But nevertheless, there are some eternal principles that these matters show us that are obviously taught in the Scriptures throughout. And so this morning, we want to consider an example of strange worship under the Old Testament. And notice some principles that we can glean from this text this morning in Leviticus 10. You may have seen that meme somewhere on Facebook. I thought, you know, that's pretty interesting, and that was on Facebook, and it was done by a denominational group of folks, as a matter of fact. And that was interesting. But again, we'll come back to that idea that's expressed in that meme a little bit later. So let's notice this morning some matters pertaining to it makes a difference how one worships. Another lesson from the law of Moses. Let's consider in the first place this morning that when it came time to worship under the Old Testament system, fire was used. Fire was used. And as you begin to look at all the offerings that were offered under the Old Testament system, it's interesting if you begin in Leviticus chapter 1 and you read to Leviticus chapter 5, so Leviticus 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, you will see all five of the offerings that were offered under the Old Testament system, one right after the other. So it makes it very easy in sequence to learn about those different offerings. But again, we see that under the Old Testament system, fire was used in all the offerings. Every single offering, all five of them, incorporated fire in offering to the true and living God. For example, we have the first offering mentioned in Leviticus 1 and also in Exodus chapter 29, which is what we'll reference. There was the burnt offering. In Exodus chapter 29 and verse 18, the Bible says, "And you shall burn the whole ram on the altar." Notice, it is a burnt offering, so that's the kind of offering to the Lord. It is a sweet aroma, an offering made by fire to the Lord. So again, fire was obviously used in connection with the burnt offering. Makes sense, since it's called a burnt offering, that you would use fire. But again, fire was used with that offering. Now this offering, by the way, signified, when it was offered, a complete surrender to God. So whenever the Israelites offered this burnt offering, it represented that, hey, I'm surrendering all to God. You know, we sing that song, "I Surrender All," don't we? It was that kind of an idea. All of the animal that was offered, whether it be of the herd, as Leviticus 1:3 says, or of the flock, Leviticus chapter 1, verse 10, or of the fowl of the air, Leviticus 1:14, all of it was to be consumed by fire upon the altar, Leviticus chapter 1, verse 9. So there was one offering, and again, it was with fire. Then you have the grain and the drink offerings as well. In Exodus 29, verse 41, "And the other lamb you shall offer at twilight, and you shall offer it with a grain offering and the drink offering, as in the morning for a sweet aroma, an offering," notice again, "made by fire to the Lord." So again, fire is always used in connection with the offerings, and no different for the grain offering and the drink offering. Now, the grain offering signified the devotion of one's labor to God. The idea of service and work is the prominent idea behind the grain offering. And so when the grain offering was offered, it consisted of fine flour with frankincense, Leviticus 2, verse 1. Unleavened cakes mingled with oil, Leviticus 2, verse 4. Or green full ears of corn, Leviticus 2, 14. And again, it was to be consumed by fire upon the altar, Leviticus 2, verse 2. The third offering is called the peace offerings. The peace offerings. We read about this in Leviticus chapter 3 as well as other places, but specifically in Leviticus 3 verse 3, the Bible says, "Then he shall offer from the sacrifice of the peace offering, an offering," again, "made by fire to the Lord, the fat that covers the entrails and all the fat that is on the entrails." So again, fire is used in connection with this offering. Now this offering reminded Israel of the blessings they received because they had fellowship with God. They had peace with God. And that's what the peace offering signified. And there were three kinds of peace offerings, by the way. There was the thanksgiving offering. In Leviticus 7, it talks more about the peace offering as well. Leviticus 7, verses 11 to 15 talks about the thanksgiving peace offering. You had the vow or the votive offering that was offered as well, Leviticus 7, 16. And then you had a voluntary peace offering in Leviticus 7, verse 16. This offering consisted of a male or female of a herd, according to chapter 3, verse 1 of Leviticus. Also could consist of the flock, chapter 3, verse 6, or goat, Leviticus 3, 12, all of which were without blemish, without fault. And so, additionally, we learned from Leviticus 3, verses 4 and 5, that there were only certain parts to be burned by fire, but again, it still was consumed by fire. So we see the consistency in the fire being offered. And then you had number 4, the sin offering. Sin offering was the fourth offering that Israelites offered under the old covenant. This offering reminded Israel that to approach the Lord, they had to have their sins forgiven. If they were going to worship God, if they were going to be pleasing to God, they had to offer this sin offering. In fact, the high priest himself had to go in and offer an offering for himself before he could offer for the people. And so in Exodus 29, verse 14, it says about the sin offering, but the flesh of the bull and its hide and its refuse you shall burn with fire. Notice, outside the camp of the Israelites, it is a sin offering. So it was burned outside the camp, but it still was burned by fire. And so the high priest would offer first his sin offering, and then he offered on behalf of all Israel after that, Leviticus 4:13. So the priest would lay his hands on the head of the bull, and he would kill it for his offering, Leviticus 4, verse 4. And then when the people sinned, the elders would go and lay their hands on the head of the bull, and then it would be killed, Leviticus 4, 15. And so there was that need to place the hands on the offering, the animal, before it was offered. That putting the hands on the animal signified transferring my guilt of sin onto this animal. And so this animal, in a figurative way, is going to bear my sin, and so when it is offered, that sin will be taken away. Isn't that what Jesus essentially did? As the Lamb of God, John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He was our sin offering. And he was offered on our behalf, finally and completely, to make sure that all of us had our sins forgiven. Now, going back to the sin offering under the Old Covenant, part of the sacrifice, the fat, etc., was burned on the altar, and then the rest of it, as this text says in Exodus 29, verse 1, was burned outside of the camp. And then, finally, the fifth offering is called the trespass offering. We read about that in Leviticus chapter 5, among other places. And also Leviticus 7, verse 5, it says, and the priest shall burn them on the altar as an offering made by fire. Again, fire is used in all the offerings. It is a trespass offering. Now, while the sin and the trespass offering were closely related, the main difference between the sin offering and the trespass offering is that the sin offering recognized sin toward God, while the trespass offering recognized sin toward one's fellow man. I trespassed against you. I've done something against you. And so offerings of the female from the flock was the usual offering, unless folks under the old covenant were unable to provide that. And then certain exceptions were made, or provisions were made. Leviticus 5, 6 through 11 talks about that. But here's the point that we're getting at. All of these offerings were made with fire. And so, if you notice in the outline this morning, number 2, we observe that fire was used as Israel worshipped in Leviticus chapter 9. Leviticus chapter 9 is very important. Because in Leviticus chapter 9, as one man notes in the Beacon Bible Commentary on volume 1, page 348, Leviticus 9 is important because it records the first public sacrifices of Israel under the Levitical priesthood. So you think about it. As you read your Old Testaments, as you read in Exodus about the offerings that we see in Exodus 29 that we mentioned this morning, and as you read from Leviticus chapter 1 to chapter 5, and then you pick up some other details about the offerings from Leviticus chapter 7 and 8, you see that the Israelites were being prepared for the very first time as a nation to offer all of these offerings to God. So you can imagine how important it was in the nation of Israel when Leviticus chapter 9 records the first offerings ever as a nation to be offered. Needless to say, it was a very important day in their history. And you would think, given all the preparation that God had done for his servant Moses and Aaron, that people would be very careful, right? Make sure we get this right. God has told us what he wants. Let's pay very close attention to make sure that we offer the right sacrifices. Let's make sure that we do it the way that God has specified in his word. And so all of the offerings that we just mentioned were offered on that day, with the exception of the trespass offering. The trespass offering is not recorded, at least, as being offered on that day. So, for example, in Leviticus chapter 9, verses 8 through 14, Aaron offered the sin offering and the burnt offering for his behalf and his son's behalf. Remember, before he could do anything else, he had to offer on his behalf according to the commandment of God. And then you go on to read in Leviticus 9, verse 15 to 21, then Aaron offers the people's offerings. The sin offering, the peace offering, the burnt offering, and the grain offering are recorded as being offered on that occasion. And then in verses 22 to 24 of Leviticus 9, Aaron blesses the people while the fire of the Lord comes down and consumes the burnt offering. So again, what we can clearly establish, if nothing else, from all this information that we just went over, is that it is clear that fire was used in these sacrifices. But then when we come to Leviticus chapter 10, in the second place, we observe that fire was abused. Fire was abused. It was supposed to be used and used in the right way, but when we come to Leviticus 10, we see now fire being abused. And the reason why it was abused, as we can observe in Leviticus 10, verse 1, is because it was strange fire. It was strange fire. Again, we call our attention to Leviticus 10, verse 1, and Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein and put incense thereon and offered strange, New King James Version says, profane fire before the Lord. And then notice this phrase, which he commanded them not. There's the issue of authority. He didn't say you could do this, Nadab and Abihu. And so they offered strange fire before the Lord. A little bit about Aaron and his sons. We are reminded in Exodus chapter 6, verse 23, that Aaron had four sons. Aaron took to himself Elisha, the daughter of Aminadab, sister of Nashon, his wife, and she bore him Nadab, Abihu, Eleazar, and Ithamar. And typically, whenever children are listed in the scriptures, the oldest is mentioned first, and the youngest is mentioned last. So Nadab and Abihu were the oldest ones of Aaron's sons. We are told in Leviticus 10, verse 1, that they took a censer. Well, what's a censer? The censer, as it's called, was a pan of hot coals, and that pan of hot coals was used to transfer and take the fire in different places, and also incense was used in connection with the hot coals in the censer. And so the Bible says that when they took their censer and put fire and incense on it, that it was strange fire. That's what the Old King James says, strange fire. Again, New King James says profane fire. I like how one translation puts it in Leviticus 10, verse 1, the English Standard Version, and also the Christian Standard Bible mentions this as well. Now, Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it and laid incense on it and offered, notice, unauthorized fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. Unauthorized. This is something God didn't authorize that they had offered. And so these two translations no doubt capture the essence or the meaning that we are to come away with from it. Now, to be fair, that's not what the Hebrew word means. It's not, it doesn't, in no Bible dictionary that I checked, does unauthorized, is it used as a way to translate the Hebrew word, but no doubt these translators were trying to give the reader the meaning of what that would indicate. And so really the word itself means to be strange. Brown Driver Briggs Hebrew Lexicon simply says that's what it means. It means to be strange. Strong's goes in a little bit more detail. Apparently this word had an idea, behind it with a traveler, someone traveling to a foreign country perhaps, and so they would turn aside. And so the word kind of gave the idea of to turn aside, especially for lodging. So in other words, you're going a certain direction, you're on a road, and instead of staying on that road, you turn aside, you go somewhere different than where you were going in order to perhaps, you know, sleep that night to continue your journey the next day. So obviously nothing about that that's wrong or in and of itself, but that's where the idea evidently came from. It means to turn aside. And then it became broader when you talk about certain ideas, hence to be a stranger or a foreigner, something that is strange or different. And of course, profane is another way to translate it, as the New King James mentioned. So what they did was foreign. What Nadab and Abihu did was foreign to what God had specified. It was strange from in the theological word book of the Old Testament says that the basic thought behind the word is of non-acquaintance or non-relatedness. So this fire was not related to the fire that God wanted. It had no relationship to it. It was strange. It was different. And so all of these shades of meaning come behind that original Hebrew word. Now, did the Lord specifically say, now, Nadab and Abihu, thou shalt not offer me something different than what I specified. Thou shalt not offer to me this different kind of fire than what I specified. The Bible doesn't say we can't do that, so it must be okay. That's a really strange way of reasoning, isn't it? Because I always thought we were supposed to go by what the Bible does say, not by what it doesn't say. You think about trying to live your life by what the Bible doesn't say, and that's exactly what God has told us not to do, by specifying what we're supposed to do. You know, for example, how many times does the Bible say, or, you know, does the Bible say, we might ask, does the Bible say that we are to give? Well, yeah, it does. In Luke 6:38, Jesus said, give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, running over into your bosom, shall men give to you. So the idea of giving is something that Jesus expects of those who follow Him. Well, is there an example of how giving is to be done for example, the church? Well, yeah. 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 and 2, and really beyond that, talks about an example of when the collection was gathered together. When? On the first day of the week. And they were to lay by in store, and they were to give. And so there's an example of how this giving is carried out. Where in the Bible does it ever say that if there's a need in the church that you need to hold, you know, a bake sale? Where in the Bible does it say that if there's a need in the church, for example, you have an auction or a fundraiser, and then you raise money among folks out in the community to, for example, support a missionary or something? It doesn't say that, does it? It's all interesting whenever I've gone places and there's something set up in front of a store. Would you buy some donuts to raise money for mission work? And I think to myself, well, hasn't God specified how to raise funds for the needs of the church? Yeah, He has. 1 Corinthians 16 tells us exactly how to do that. And it's supposed to be among those who are members of the body of Christ. There's no authority beyond that. Or does the Bible not say that we are to sing in the assembly? For example, Ephesians 5:19, Colossians 3:16 talks about we all sing collectively as a congregation. But show me in the Bible where the church ever used or introduced an instrument into worship, for example. Where is that ever found? Where is that ever found? So God has specified something, and people want to do like Nadab and Abihu. They want to introduce something strange. They want to introduce something foreign from what God has specified. And so we can see how that plays out. And yet some people will say, well, the Bible doesn't say thou shalt not have a bake sale. The Bible doesn't say thou shalt not use instrumental music in worship. Well, the Bible doesn't say a lot of things. The Bible never says thou shalt not use cocaine. I think we have enough sense to know that if I'm supposed to treat my body the way that the Bible describes in 1 Corinthians 6, it belongs to the Lord, I'm not going to do things to intentionally harm my body. The Bible doesn't say thou shalt not use steak and cake for communion. But we know by what God has specified, the bread and the fruit of the vine, that excludes everything else. So our plea is, why can't we just go back to the Bible and just do what God said, unlike Nadab and Abihu? And so we observe that fire was abused by Nadab and Abihu in that it was strange fire. And then number two, we observe it was not acceptable worship. It was not acceptable worship. How do we know that Nadab and Abihu's worship was not okay with God? How do we know that Nadab and Abihu's worship was not accepted by God? Could it be any clearer? Leviticus 10 verse 2, so fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. They could have reasoned all they want to, well, God didn't say this and God didn't say that, and he answered that question. That's not okay. It's not okay. Could it be any more clear when God devours them with fire when they did something that wasn't authorized in worship? One of the things that we must communicate to folks is that there's such a thing as true worship and false worship. There is a difference. And it's interesting because I wonder if we talk to a random stranger on the street who may worship somewhere today other than here, you know, is there something different than what God has specified as far as worship? In other words, is there such a thing as false worship, or is any worship okay? You know, think about what Jesus said to the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4. And he points out how the Samaritans were not worshiping God acceptably. And then he tells her in John 4:23, but the hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers, oh, that's interesting, true worshipers. That implies those who are not worshiping truly. When the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. So God is seeking true worshipers. Would that indicate he's not seeking false worshipers? I would think so, since he specified true worshipers is what he wants. He doesn't want people to worship him in a way that is not true. And so we observe that when it came time for Nadab and Abihu to worship, instead of using what God had specified, fire was abused. And then let's notice in the third and final place this morning, in regard to their worship, authorized fire was refused. Authorized fire was refused. And we can see this in the way that they refused authorized fire by substitution. They refused authorized fire by substitution. In other words, they substituted their way of doing things for God's way of doing things. Let's get back to this idea of strange fire, because we haven't talked about what exactly that means yet, have we? What is this strange fire? How is it that Nadab and Abihu offered something different than what God specified? What is it that they offered? Well, we don't know exactly for sure, but here are some suggestions. Some suggest that they offered the wrong kind of incense, and that made the fire strange. Some think that they offered the wrong kind of incense. In Exodus chapter 30, notice what it says beginning in verse 34. And the Lord said to Moses, take sweet spices, stocta and onica and galbanum. I don't know if I pronounced those exactly right, but you get the idea. And pure frankincense with these sweet spices. There shall be equal amounts of each. You shall make of these an incense. So that's what you're supposed to use. Nothing else. A compound according to the art of the pure perfumer, salted, pure, and holy. And you shall beat some of it very fine and put some of it before the testimony in the tabernacle meeting where I will meet with you. It shall be most holy to you. But notice the warning in verse 37. As for the incense which you shall make, you shall not make any for yourselves according to its composition. It shall be to you holy for the Lord. Whoever makes any like it, to smell it, he shall be cut off from his people. Isn't that very interesting how specific God is? And so this is how, here's the recipe for how to make the incense that you're supposed to offer before the Lord. And you might really like the smell of that. And you think to yourself, well, I'm going to make something just like that and take it home and smell it because I really love the way it smells. God says, no, you can't do that. And if you do that, you'll be cut off from your people. That's how specific God was about the incense that he wanted used in the offering. And so some suggest, well, maybe what they did, Nadab and Abihu, is they offered something different than the kind of incense that was supposed to be offered according to the recipe, if you please, in Exodus 34:34-38. Well, some suggest, well, maybe the fire came from the wrong source. Maybe they got the fire from a different place than where they were supposed to get it. Maybe that's what made it strange fire. In Leviticus 16, verses 11 and 12, the Bible says, "And Aaron shall bring the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bull as the sin offering, which is for himself. Then he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from the altar before the Lord, with his hands full of sweet incense, beaten fine, and bring it inside the veil." So the fire was to be taken from the altar where the sin offering was offered, and that was specified in connection with the incense that was to be offered. And so maybe they took fire from some other place instead of from the altar that was specified. Maybe that's what made it strange fire. Well, some suggested that the incense was not supposed to be offered at that particular moment. So was it because the fire wasn't offered at the right time? It was offered at the wrong time? Is that what made it strange fire? In Exodus 30, beginning of verse 7, the Bible says, "Aaron shall burn on it sweet incense." Notice when? Every morning when he tends the lamps, he shall burn incense on it. And when Aaron lights the lamps at twilight in the evening, he shall burn incense on it. A perpetual incense before the Lord throughout generations. So two times when it was supposed to be offered. Did they offer it at a time other than when it was specified? Is that what made it strange fire? Others suggest that Nadab and Abihu assumed a role that was not theirs when they offered the fire. Instead, it was supposed to be the high priest's, their father Aaron's. Maybe that's what made it strange fire. And then finally, it's interesting in Leviticus chapter 10 that immediately after you read about what happened with Nadab and Abihu and then the aftermath of that, in Leviticus 10 verses 8 through 11, God talks about using alcohol and becoming intoxicated. Was it because Nadab and Abihu were intoxicated when they offered the fire? It's interesting, Leviticus 10, verse 8, immediately after these events, then the Lord spoke to Aaron, saying, "Do not drink wine or intoxicating drink, you nor your sons with you, when you go into the tabernacle meeting, lest you die." So he talks about it being a statute and how that it distinguishes between holiness and unholiness. Kind of doubt that's what happened in Leviticus 10. But some people offer it as a suggestion because, again, it's interesting how that's talked about immediately after in Leviticus 10. But I would not be surprised if in Leviticus 10 it were not a combination of a few of the items that we mentioned. Maybe the wrong kind of incense. Maybe it came from the wrong source. But whatever the case, the fact remains that they accepted a practice other than what God had specified. Back in Exodus 32, remember when Aaron tried to substitute a golden calf for what was supposed to be worship offered to the true and living God? So they saw that example themselves of their father substituting what God had wanted by offering the golden calf and making a golden calf for the people to worship. And then we observe that in addition to Nadab and Abihu refusing fire and substitution, they refused authorized fire in presumption. They presumed that it was okay to do what they did. What was it that possessed them to think that God would allow them to do what they did? They presumed that the way they were doing things, well, that'll be just fine with God. God won't mind. It'll be okay. They learned different, didn't they? Just like Nadab and Abihu, sadly, many today make the same mistake. They think, oh, what we're doing over here is fine and good with God. He must be pleased. But they never stop and ask the question, is this authorized by God? What if Nadab and Abihu had stopped and asked themselves, is this authorized by God? That would probably make a world of difference in their lives. And when you question people, sadly today, why they do the things they do, they may say, well, I just believe, you know, as long as you're sincere, God will accept it. Do we really think necessarily that Nadab and Abihu were insincere? Did they wake up that morning and say, let's try to do something really awful so that God will kill us? I doubt Nadab and Abihu woke up that day thinking that. So we don't have any reason to believe they weren't sincere in what they were doing. They were sincerely wrong. And so we need to think about very carefully. It makes a difference how one worships God. We can't offer strange worship to God, just like they offered strange fire, and think it's going to be okay with God. It's just simply not going to be that way. The Bible makes that clear all the way throughout. We cannot set aside God's authority. And while God isn't going to cause fire to come down and consume us like he did with Nadab and Abihu, that was a miracle, and we're told that age of miraculous has at times have ceased. Nevertheless, is there still not fire awaiting those who disobey God's commands? You know, Jesus, you know, you talk about love and loving God, and that's so important that we love God, but how do we show we love God? Did Jesus make it any more, could he make it any more clearer than he did in John 14, 15? If you love me, keep my commandments. So we want to do what God has told us to do. Why? Because we love him. Because we love him, and he deserves to be honored and worshipped in the way that he has told us to do in his word. You know, also, it's interesting how sometimes folks will set aside what the Bible says in regard to salvation. You know, they'll say, hey, if you want to be saved, just come and invite Jesus into your heart, pray a little prayer with me, and make him your personal Savior. Where did anybody ever do that in the Bible? Where? Nowhere I've ever read. So if I want to be saved according to what the Bible says, that means I come to God's Word and I read it. And I see that the only way I can have legitimate faith, the kind of faith that's biblical, is Romans 10, 17. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. There's no other way to get the kind of faith that God wants us to have. And this book tells me that out of that faith, I'm to repent of my sins, because God commands all men everywhere to repent, Acts 17, 30. God says that we are to confess with the mouth the Lord Jesus, Romans 10, 10. And the Bible says that we are to be immersed into water, 1 Peter 3, 21, to be saved. 16. That's what God has specified. And anything beyond that is not what God has specified. And so if I want to be saved the way the Bible says, that's what I'll do. I'll hear the Word of God to create faith, leading me to repentance, confessing his sweet name, and being immersed into water for the forgiveness of sins. And then I know that once I do that, I don't somehow become sinless. I don't somehow, you know, become above sin. No, I'll still sin because of weakness or immaturity or ignorance. I don't have to go through that process again because I'm already a Christian. Instead, I go to God in repentance, just like our fellow Christian Simon did in Acts 8:22. I confess that sin before God's throne, 1 John 1:9, and God promises he'll cleanse me from all unrighteousness because I already have that relationship with him. And so this morning, if you're subject to the invitation of our Lord, and we can help you obeying him in any way, would you please come as we stand and sing this invitation song? Hark
the gentle voice of Jesus calleth, tenderly upon your ear. Sweet. Upon your
morning's scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verses 26 through 29. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
before you eat it, to take this cup that represents Christ's body that was shed on that cross and Calvary, dear Lord. Just remember when he was up there that he stayed and asked that you would forgive those who crucified him. Let's also forgive those who do us wrong, dear Lord. And if you would, dear Lord, please forgive us of our sins. Let's always remember his great love and sacrifice for us, dear Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. This time communion's over, and we'll take a prayer for the offering. Dear Lord, you ask us to lay aside once a week for our offering. Let's give an offering to you, dear Lord, and be thankful for all the blessings bestowed on us, dear Lord. Let's be thankful for the country we live in, the homes we have, dear Lord, the jobs you give us to do, the schools we have, the leaders of our nation, and all the other material things you bless us with, dear Lord. Let's be thankful for our friends, family, loved ones. Let's always be the best Christians we can be, dear Lord. If you would, dear Lord, let us sow the seed of the kingdom the best way we can. Whatever talents we have, let us put those, use the best we can to glorify you and your Son. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Again, we'd like to welcome any guests we have among us this morning. There are 114 here in the building, 17 online, for a total of 131. If it's convenient, let us stand, please.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his praise. In the mansion bright and blessed, here prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the cross of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.